So joining us today, first we have Kathy Plesko. Next up is Vishal Patel. And joining us from the National Ignition Facility, we have Peter Thalen and Chris Edwards. Could we contain plasma energy with strong enough electromagnetic field, like a lightsaber?
You just happen to pick up a lightsaber at the Target Walmart-type store, so let's follow this to its logical conclusion. Let's say instead of holding it in an invisible magnetic bottle, you actually have something physical that extends when you turn it on. Something very thin, but it's it can
metalized.
We're talking about a very exotic universe, right, with exotic materials we don't have now. So they have a material that is able to hold a powerful magnetic charge and hold the plasma, and perhaps that material is constantly being burned off, but constantly being replenished.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about people walking around with fusion reactors hanging off their belts and a spare one at home,
and
their land speeders powered by some really exotic power technology that these people take for granted. So power is not an issue for these folks.
Which color lightsaber uses more energy, red or blue?
Oh, blue.
Blue, definitely.
Green or blue?
Green or blue, we would imagine. It's because it's putting off green or blue photons, which are higher energy. That's our guess based upon the color.
Is the longer wavelength, lower energy, red photons are not going to take as much energy to generate, which is why all of the double-ended lightsabers should totally be red.
At one point in Empire Strikes Back, Luke plugs in R2-D2 to give him power. That suggests he's battery-operated. What kind of battery technology do you think could be in use there?
I would argue that there was some sort of power source on board of R2, and possibly the plug-in part was more for just maybe some subsystems that need a little bit more energy at once.
So, Vishal, do you think it had two batteries? The R2 unit would have, like, a radiothermal generator like the Curiosity rover does for part of it, and then...
That's what I would imagine.
How much of R2's trash can is taken up with that?
Most of it.
Most of it?
The thermal exhaust port that the Rebels used blow up the Death Star, did it keep the reactors cool, and, like, was it just a complete design flaw by the Empire?
The technical term for the exhaust port on the Death Star is MacGuffin. That is a plot monster that was there to be shot at to make the last scene awesome. The gotcha that I saw with that is they're using an exhaust port instead of fins to radiate off into space.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're using an exhaust port, that means you're venting gas out that port.
I mean,
so you'd have to have another exhaust port for equal and opposite reaction. You'd have to have another exhaust port opposite it on the other side.
And there's also the Death Star itself has propulsion mechanism such that it could counteract its the offset of that thermal exhaust port.
Is it coming? There we go. All right.
Okay. Nice Death Star.
Yeah, great.
Does the technology exist to create a real-life reflector shield, like one you may see on that Death Star over there?
I really like the laser shockwave idea, where essentially if something's coming in, you can sense it's coming in and cause some sort of shockwave to deflect it using that physical media.
Similar maybe to reactive armor that's used on some tanks now, where a projectile hits the armor and it blows up and basically cancels the force, the opposing force.
At least in the first three, the canonical real movies, I'm totally going to get flamed for that. But in the real movies, all of the weapons seem to be based on charged particles. So if the Death Star's laser is actually, say, an electron beam, which would look different, but if that was the case, and if the Rebels are always fighting back with charged proton torpedoes, then maybe a magnetic field is the right answer. Maybe that magnetic braking is what you need.
Is the Death Star energy efficient? My guess is no.
When they power up to destroy Alderaan, That's a lot of energy, and you see things sort of, you know, powering down, the lights are dimming, people are a little stressed out there, even, but if you actually look at the amount of power that takes to destroy a planet, there are very specific technical definitions of what it means to disrupt a planet like that in planetary evolution and planetary science, and it's a whole lot of energy. I have done that calculation.
Oh,
so
great.
I can tell you how much power is going into that burst.
Yeah, I've done it too.
All right, let's compare numbers.
Yeah,
okay, great. So to disrupt a planet, you have to fragment it such that the largest piece left is half of its original mass.
Yeah, I didn't do that much.
B star D. So if you're blowing away half of an Earth mass, that's going to be 3 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, right? And so you're shooting that off to infinity. We're then talking about energy in joules. So 1 joule is the amount of energy it takes to lift something about the size of a big apple, about a meter or 3 feet off the ground. And so 1 times 10 to the 24, that's the 1 with 24 zeros after it, joules, is 1, and I couldn't have made this up, yoda joule. That's Y-O-T-T-A, not Y-O-D-A, but that is a yoda joule. So really? what are your numbers looking like, Vishal?
I'm like 6 or so orders of magnitude higher than you.
Very impressive, very efficient technology, because if they had even 1% waste heat, the Death Star itself would melt.
And yeah, you don't really have to blow the whole planet apart. All you have to do is unload the crust. If you can peel the crust off using this binding energy voodoo, then the mantle is under such high pressure from having had that heavy crust on top of it that if you suddenly unloaded that, the whole thing would just blow up anyway.
Oh, that's great. Yum.
Well, Chris, you were speculating on ways to destroy a planet, weren't you?
Or even just a smallish spot on the crust. If you took off something the size of a continent, then all of a sudden you've got a continent-sized supervolcano turning the planet inside out, potentially.
Now we're talking. So we might need a lot less energy than a Yoda watt or Yoda joule.
Why are we even doing this in the first place? Why are we answering questions about a fictional universe instead of the real world?
I really was inspired by the land speeder, and my favorite quote was,
"Look at this. Ever since the XP-38 came out, they just aren't in demand.
It'll be enough."
Which allowed him
to travel
across the galaxy. And so for me, Star Wars was an inspiration, along with Star Trek, to go and explore science and think about things differently. Say, I think we're all in the boat of trying to give back and inspire that next generation. And writers do that, and I think natural lab employees can do that as well.
Dreams matter. Myths matter. The stories we tell ourselves matter. There's the things that get us up in the morning and get us out into the field, even if it's raining, to go get that one particular rock or stay until 2 in the morning to finish that calculation. And that's the fuel in my warp drive. And I think it's that way for a lot of people. And that's why I continue to be a part of the fanish community and go to science fiction conventions to talk about space and to talk about Mars and asteroids and what this amazing universe is. I think it really does matter. And I'm really grateful to the people who write these stories that give us something to show people. Hey, this, you know, maybe this couldn't happen, but big dreams can happen.